Excellent.
So I'd like to start with a question that's probably the most burning right now for all the working moms during pandemic. How do you effectively manage your time, and also how do you find time for yourself, if any, which I'm sure a lot of people think is impossible at this time. And to be honest, when I was organizing this webinar, I was thinking that we cannot just give advice to women and try to fix women, because that's not what we're trying to do here. We also want to discuss how the companies, the corporate world, the society can change and fix itself so it's easier for working women to be successful. So this is the intention. And I am very grateful for everyone today to participate. And maybe anyone who would like to take this question, Belinda or Joy, please jump in.
I think one of the ways that I got myself organized, I had to do a reality check. The thing about being at home, you can become very relaxed, and that's scary. So what I did one day, I sat out and I just wrote out what my goals were and what was the expected results from my goals. And then I sat down and for 7 days, I wrote down everything I did every day from the time I got up until the time I went to bed. When I did that, at the seventh day, I compared my calendar to my goals. They didn't line up. I saw a lot of time that I wasted. I saw a lot of idle conversation, unnecessary things that I was doing. So I think sometimes we have to accept the fact that we just get caught up and we don't stick to the plan. Does that make sense?
Right.
So I think by doing a calendar and actually just writing down, you know, if I got up at 5 and I prayed from 5 to 5:30, I went running, then I took a call from my mother, and I worked on this, and I went and talked to my neighbor, see how much time I wasted. And the goals didn't line up. The calendar didn't reflect the goals that I had. That was one of the things that gave me a reality check, was looking at the time you actually waste.
Right. I do have a follow-up on that, because I know a lot of women who literally get up and they have to turn on their computers to start working. And immediately, depending on how many kids they have, the kids will come over and they will ask different things. And also they have to turn on their computers and do Zoom class with their school. And then once they're finished, they gotta feed the child, they gotta check their homework, send it out to the teacher. And by that time, it's already over. You still have work to do. So I've been hearing a lot of kind of like, I don't go out, I definitely don't run type of scenarios.
So I wonder what would happen if we make our kids part of our company. So I work for Wells Fargo, but to the family, my business is called Belinda and Company. And each child has a responsibility. We have one-on-ones. I think when you incorporate them in it and have those conversations and have one-on-ones, it may help things move smoother. Now, all of this is based on the age of the child. But I have found in the past that have worked. It's like you're part of a business. I would go to them about my struggles and what I'm dealing with, and they would give me advice, and they felt like they was a part of something bigger. Now, when you add homework in that, that's their job, but your job is also to come in and put up the files. Sometimes by adding them into the equation of your new world, it's a little bit more respect for your time and a better understanding of what mommy's trying to do.
Right.
I have a little bit of a different experience in that my children are older, they're college age. And so what I found was they were all home as of, I think, early March last year. And my workload, even there's only two of them, seemed to quadruple.
I know, right?
So there's more cooking, certainly more cooking, more grocery shopping, more cleaning, more clutter in the house. And, you know, I just said, you guys have got to help. And they did, you know, I said, you know, they had chores that they had to do. I mean, they were used to living in a dorm and just going to the dining hall and not having to pick up after themselves. And
that's right.
I said, look, you guys, I need help. I couldn't believe how much extra work I had when they were. Plus, my husband came home, too. I mean, he was working from home also. Mm-hmm. And they all expected me to just step up and do everything. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't take as structured an approach. But the other thing I did, and even when my kids were little, was just, there were so many things I wanted to do that I couldn't get to. And I would get frustrated. And then I thought, Joy, you know, those are just things that are going to have to wait. Mm-hmm. So I learned to drop those things and to do the things that I absolutely had to do to be able to keep up. Right. When my kids were 13, I taught them how to do their own laundry. And they did from the time they were 13 on. So things like that, I was able to delegate at an age appropriate time,
right,
to be able to move forward. And I think one of the key things for me, regardless of COVID or not, is to be sure you find time for yourself every day.
Every day.
Whether that is 5 minutes, I don't care. It's your time. I don't care if you lock yourself in the bathroom.
Put yourself in timeout.
Just give yourself a timeout. And I don't care what you do with that time. Maybe that's your time to exercise. Maybe that's your time to meditate. Maybe that's your time to talk to your sister or your friend or your mother or whatever it is for you. You have to have that time to stay grounded and keep your sanity.
I think one main factor that we're not, you know, adding into the equation is that this is very traumatic for the children. I mean, their whole world has been turned upside down. You know, why can't we go to grandma's house? Why can't I meet with my friends? Why can't we go to McDonald's? What happened to IHOP? They're trying to figure this out in their mind, which contributes to a lot of the frustration you're getting from them. And I don't think we're taking in equation that they're struggling too, because nothing makes sense. Their whole world has been turned upside down.
I think that's a really good point. I think our children, in so many ways, even the stresses that they're faced with in today's world without COVID, are intellectually capable of handling it, but they're not emotionally mature enough to manage the stress around it. For example, I had a senior in high school this year. There was no prom. There was no beach week. There was no graduation.
That's a lot.
And now she's transitioning to college. And, you know, there's no leaving your dorm room without a mask on.
Right.
Her parents, my husband and I have a 2-hour window to move her in, and we have to leave. We're not allowed to stay.
Wow.
She wanted to pledge a sorority. It's all going to be virtual. There's no fraternity parties. There's no football games. There's no college experience other than online classes in your dorm room.
Yeah, that's hard. I mean, can you imagine going to school for 12 years and you look forward to graduation and now there is no graduation? That's a hard pill to swallow.
And
it's very difficult for them.
Unfortunately, in my mind, as moms, we do put a lot of pressure on ourselves into dealing with all of these situations. So we become a coach without realizing it, trying to influence our kids. We become coach trying to influence our husbands and our colleagues and everything. So in my mind, what can we do? Like, for example, from Wade's point of view, I'm really interested what he has to say about doing it correctly and also maybe really dumping some of that load to your partner. Because that's why you get married, to really take that load together and do it effectively together. And even when you are a single mom, how do you engage the other partner the parent of the child to help. And also the word help is even the one that's really like putting us in this, the driver's seat.
Right.
So you have to like take a step back a bit and give that ownership to someone else in your life as well. So what do you think about that?
Well, thank you. First, I have to say, I keep thinking of this panel and I think of those games, those things that we had as kids, you know, which one doesn't belong, where you have three pictures, you have four pictures, there are three birds and a goat. Which one doesn't, I'm the goat here, all right?
Okay.
No, I'm coming from a very different perspective. I should say that my wife and I have had a very traditional marriage. She was mostly stay-at-home mom, but before that, part-time work, and during that and after that, part-time work. So there was sort of that traditional bend there. I will call myself, and this is how I came to our most attention, a late-in-life feminist, having realized that I lived in a very skewed world, and that world was very skewed in my direction. And that's nice, except if you believe in fairness and justice and sharing and that kind of thing. And all of a sudden you realize your comfort may not be based on others' comfort. It may be based on other discomfort. So I think it's important, especially for men, to come to that realization. I heard a couple of things listening to you, and I really appreciate it. I think one of the things that comes up, and I've experienced, and my wife has experienced, and full disclosure, my wife and I are separated. I did not learn these things soon enough. I did not get there soon enough. We actually have a really good relationship. I took off a day to go help her with stuff this week around our house where she lives versus our house where I live. I come to you with a great deal of failed effort, hopefully I've learned a lot more, and we'll see where things go. But there were a couple of things about just setting boundaries for yourself, making sure that, you know, this is something, and I have to deal with this in work. I don't deal with it raising kids now. Our kids are both in their late 20s or 30, and, you know, they're both out, et cetera. But what are the boundaries? You have to have space for yourself. And even I have to fight with this. My weakness is not ever, I haven't said no to the office. I say, well, it's hard for me to say no. And then one day I realized, wait a second, it's hard for me to say no to my boss. But every time I say yes to my boss, I say no to my wife. So actually, I'm very good at saying no. It's just I've got my priorities poorly organized, out of sync. So as a consequence, it's been a slow learn for me, but I hear these things. How do you set boundaries? It's been intense lately at work. You won't be surprised to know, very intense. I have to take some time in the morning and just sit. I grab a cup of coffee and I sit on the patio. I have my breakfast. I decide when I'm going to turn on my computer. And I take some time during the day. I'll just walk outside or go sit on my patio. I have a bird feeder. Go sit and stare at the birds. You know, I need that psychological downtime as well. So I am not, I don't come to you as a gold medal winner in setting those boundaries, but I have come to see the importance. And I'm hearing you say the same thing. You got to just have that. But the big thing that Anar just said, and this is part of my work, I work on women's economic empowerment, gender equality and female empowerment. That's what I get paid to do. It's ironic in many ways. There are men feminists, there are men that are a part of this, and not all of us have had to make a mess of our lives before we realized there was a better way. But one of the things that I've learned and that Anar just referred to was, this is work, period. There's no adjective. It's work that needs to be done. It's not women's work. It's not man's work. It's work. A colleague and I like to say a dirty toilet has no gender. It just needs to be cleaned.
Right.
And many of us men especially, all of us have grown up with some sense of women's work versus men's work. And since a lot of that women's work is the domestic, the unpaid care that makes up sometimes 25% of a woman's week and 5 to 10% of a man's week. with all of that unpaid care out there, we have to recognize our unpaid work. We have to recognize its value and that it's not women's work. You know, it's funny, if you get paid for dishwashing, that's a man's job. If you don't get paid, it's a woman's job.
Yeah.
If we see this in various ways all over the world. Once the money comes in, somehow it becomes male. And part of that is our insecurities over masculinity and whether we have the larger salary. I have to say, I've never understood men who were threatened by the idea that their wife could earn more than them. He would love for my wife to earn more than me. But, you know, the fact is many men are threatened by these things. And I'd say there's a lot, I'd say male insecurity is the default. I think we are very insecure about a lot of things when it comes to these issues and questions. But I think part of our conversations need to be, and my wife did this some with me, and it worked some, though I still was hard to change. This is just work. You know, it's not like she wants to clean all the toilets. They need to be cleaned. It's not like she doesn't want to have fun. She just, no, she wants to have fun too, but there are things that need to be done. And it can't just fall to one person. We did have some good divisions of labor. You know, she cooked, I cleaned up, you know, I did the dishes. Hers, those were not hers to do. That was, you know, that was negotiated. This is just fairness. Maybe we both want to go sit and watch TV after dinner. Well, that's great. She cooked it while I did whatever. And now I can clean it while she did whatever. We had some interesting negotiations when the girls were really little, which was only one of us could nurse a baby. So the other one had to get up when the baby got. So, you know, nursing could take place anytime, day or night. But when that baby woke up at 6 a.m., it was my turn to take on. And actually that changed me in a good way. I really changed my sleeping patterns forever. I'm an early morning person now. I will also say, and this is something I hope all fathers find, that time alone with my daughters was fantastic. Even before they were talking and walking, I would put them in a backpack. You know, one I would put in a backpack and go for a walk in the park, and we bonded. It was really beautiful. But if it was women's work that I was doing, well, that's not beautiful. You know, it takes a mindset change, and that mindset change takes time. I think there are a lot of journeys to it. I think we'll talk some about how we can approach that a little better. But it's work. We're raising a family, as Belinda said. Belinda and Company and Inc. Well, you know, this is a family endeavor. It's not Wade's world. It's not Karen's world. It's a family. A family requires certain things. We have to get those done. Let's figure out how we work it out. And yeah, if one has a more paid work than the other and more hours than the other, maybe you divide up some of the chores accordingly. But these are chores. And maybe you do a good job of teaching the kids to do a lot of this stuff. Why not? It's not child labor. It's getting along.
It's chores, yeah.
It's chores.
That's true. That's
it's learning to take responsibility.
Times, you folks right. are talking about, you know, you've got the kids in the home now. And I love that. One just unbroken snow day. It was fun for a little while.
But oh, baby.
Yeah.
And well, I think that you. We realize just how undisciplined we are. You know, we have to have a box to go to work. Now that box is not there. That box is at home. And I think a lot of us are surprised just how undisciplined we are because we needed that box.
Right. One of the things I've noticed with COVID since we've all been home is that not only have I set boundaries for my children and helping a little bit more, but my husband has picked up more things on his own without me having to ask. And I think to go back to what we were talking about a few minutes ago, you know, it's proven, it's scientifically proven that men think differently than women do. And if you look, and I can't quote the studies, but if you look at the MRI studies, you'll see that a man has the ability to focus to the exclusion of many other things, where a woman's brain doesn't work that way. If you see a woman's brain, the whole brain will light up and we'll be looking at multiple things at one time. And sometimes I envy men's ability to be able to focus that well. And sometimes I don't. I appreciate what I can do as a woman. But what I have found is that I've noticed that my husband didn't always see the things that I saw. And if I asked him to help, he was always willing to help and always, you know, a contributing partner. But one thing I've noticed with COVID is because we're all home, he does notice a little bit more as he walks through the house. And there's been many times that I've thought to myself, gee, I got to go clean the kitchen up from breakfast, and I'll come down and he will have already done it without me asking. So I think going back to the point of setting boundaries and asking for help, we have to appreciate that our brains work differently. And if you're overwhelmed, ask for help. You know, husbands are perfectly willing to help. They just don't see what we see sometimes.
And I think I learned that the hard way when I was married. I asked my ex-husband, I was married at the time, I said, I need for you to wash the clothes and then mop the floors, because we had hardwood floors downstairs. So me and the kids go out, and I come back in, the machine is going, and he's watching TV, and the floor is not mopped. And I said, why aren't you mopping the floor? He said, I'm waiting for the clothes to finish. So you're right, they don't see things.
I like that.
Sequential.
Yeah.
Very linear in their thinking, from my experience.
When the clothes finish washing, I can mop the floor. I thought I was going to levitate.
Unfortunately, I mean, I would say it's a matter of experience. Mm-hmm. I don't want to doubt that there are studies that women and men think differently, and there are some brain MRIs that light up differently, maybe mm-hmm. because I haven't seen those. But I know from my experience that if there is an area that I haven't been exposed to and I have no experience doing it, I wouldn't know the sequence. I wouldn't know the details. And I'm fortunate enough to have a husband who is, you know, probably more helpful in the domestic life than me, like more adapted to it. Like I can cook, for example, and he's a great cook. So if I were to start doing something, I'm sure I would leave out some details. And then, you know, it's just a matter of being exposed. And once you start getting that experience, then you learn. Huh? So I have a feeling that it's, you know, there's a lot to do about the experience. And as women, we do have certain capability, maybe more so, of being aware of what's going on. But it's also probably because of our instincts of, like, when I had a child, I wasn't aware of how much, like, things that are laying around that we need to pick up, and like the things that can harm her, like all the child proofing.
Yeah,
that's a lot. It's so alert in the minds of the mom because of the bond with the little newborn. And the men, sometimes they want their kid to be more, I don't know, brave and strong, and be careful not to bump their head without the some kind of a head wrapper around
the helmet
that you can buy on Amazon. So it depends on the toleration level of different parents.
Right.
But I just wanted to make a point that it's great. I think it's a good strategy to definitely ask help and assign tasks to your partner. But also, like I had an interview with Eve Rotsky. She's the author of a book, Fair Play. And she talks about when you assign a task and someone picks it up, they have to own the whole task from the beginning till the end. Like if someone is cooking, they also need to do all the groceries that go into a certain meal. And prepare it and then cook it. So it depends, like it's definitely the thing where then they will gain the whole experience of like knowing that mopping the floors and doing laundry doesn't have to be sequential. So,
but I think my father, who I was a daddy's girl, I always say that, taught me a very valuable lesson one day when I was complaining about my ex-husband. And I was like, he doesn't do this and da-da-da-da-da. And my daddy said, if you have $500 in the bank, can you withdraw $1,000? I said, no, because I only have $500. He said, so why do you keep trying to withdraw something out of this man that's never been deposited? And it's like a bell went off. Okay, he grew up in a single-parent home. He doesn't know what a husband or father is supposed to do. So I think sometimes we have to take into account that people are like banks, and you can only take out what's been deposited. And we need to take that in consideration when we are marrying people. You're like, you know, if that's not been deposited in him, you can't pull it out. You'll always come up insufficient funds.
Right.
I really like that.
It's a really great one. And I want to transition the conversation to more of a workplace now, because like this is just like the bank. Let's say you're a single mom. You don't have any help at home. And you have a demanding job. How do you manage the job and try not to lose it as well in the pandemic situation where this is at risk? Like, can you share those type of strategies? What do you do with your colleagues, with your boss?
I think having Xanax and a drip, an IV helps. In the chair. Just walk around the house with a cold. You have to manage yourself. And that's the hard thing, because when you're home, you're distracted with so many different things. It's almost like you got to create this workspace. It cannot be in your bedroom, and that is your office. And you go in there, and that's where you have to get things done. One thing that I do, at the end of the day, I email myself a recap of my day to say, this is what I completed. And it helps me see, did I get things done? And it also gives me my to-do list the next day. I think recapping your day, I think having friends that agree to let you, to make them accountable. So you may set up a team of friends that you can go to and say, this is what I'm doing now. This is a struggle for me. This is new for me. So I'm going to need you to make sure that I'm accountable for what I'm doing. Take their advice. And I think the conversation should start off with, I want you to be a part of my success. I need you in my life. And then people kind of open up. Even your husband will open up and say, okay, how can I help you? Because you're going in saying, I want you to be a part of my success. I'm going to be successful at this. But I have these, you know, struggles or these hurdles. And you do one-on-ones with those people. I think also getting together with the people that you work with in your office is also a good coping mechanism, because now you're, so just like maybe an hour at the movie is normal again. But having that workplace, that is what that place is for. You don't go in there on Saturday. You don't go in there on Sunday, just like you don't go to the bank and work on Saturday and Sunday.
Right.
You need to define that as 9 to 5. And you cannot let it overtake you, because it will consume you. That would be my first piece of advice. I think my recaps to myself at the end of the day was very interesting of what I got done and what I didn't get done, but it helped me the next day to plan.
And I really like the part about accountability together with your colleagues at work, because then it makes them invested in your success, but also they start feeling like, okay, if I delay my part of work, your part of work is going to be delayed, and it's going to have the exactly impact. They will know exactly what might happen to you, and that can motivate them to be more compassionate and you know, get organized, because they will see how it's impacting you. That's really great.
But you have to teach your kids that. My son Benjamin is like 6'5", and I said I would have an avatar for a child. So that's a lot of body mass in the house. And, you know, he, even at 20 years old, he can be very needy. So there are conversations taking place all the time. And it usually starts off, I'm going to punch you in your eye. But then once we get past that, it kind of works out.
Right.
I think there's another.
I think there is a question from our participants, and I just want to spotlight the video. Hi. Yes, Hasna?
Just to address your question, because I feel like it matches my my case. I have a 10-year-old. I'm a single mom, so as you say, you have to do it all. You're on your own.
That's right.
The one thing that I mean, I wish if I had good strategies, which I don't, unfortunately. We're just dealing with it the way the way we can. But the one thing that I can say, when you are responsible for paying bills, the first thing that is going to come first is your work. So for me, it was clear work was a priority, number one. School was a priority for my son. It was very hard for the county we're in because it took a good 2 months and it was really, really brutal. The county did not know how to deal with the online learning. It was working for 2 months, which made it hard on us to assist the students in elementary school because they need that assistance. Work, because it was a priority, it became harder, a lot harder. I was working a lot more hours. Fortunately, I have a good relationship with my boss, I cannot tell her no. She had many people quitting, and she had also a person locked down outside of the country and couldn't telework. So I had to cover for other portfolios, which was a lot harder. The one thing that I kept in mind, which helped a lot, is take advantage of this time where we're not busy, active, physically mm-hmm. active. We're kind of lost in our activities and sports, and take advantage of it and see what could come out positive from it. Mm-hmm. The one that came out very positive from it is I really became very, I strengthened my relationship with old, very old friends, with family. Mm-hmm. I cannot stress how a great thing we'll appreciate about this pandemic. To organize myself, I just reach out to my old friends, girlfriends, and we just decided that every Saturday we'll be on Zoom together or we'll be on WhatsApp. Mm-hmm. We're going to cook together. And we mm-hmm. spend 6 hours, we cook for the week, mm-hmm. which is everything, but we got so close during this pandemic, which I when I noticed that, I was telling my son, look, this is a very important, a very, very interesting phase, and a very important one, because I feel that this generation, and us included, in the younger one, they will learn how to appreciate things in life, the small things. Mm-hmm. How to appreciate coming up and waking up in the morning and mm-hmm. shower, take care of yourself and go meet people, talk to people, commute with people, go to a sports game, have actually a soccer game, mm-hmm. feeling of being in a team and winning and losing, all those things. I feel that children will come to appreciate that. As much as we do, like, for example, mm-hmm. today, appreciate a lot the very small things that we do in life. Mm-hmm. Need a lot. Just to say that although this is hard and still not, I look at 5 months ahead, we're going to be at home. Students, they're going to be at home. We have mm-hmm. none of them. We did so far, we're going to do it again. That's mm-hmm. for sure. That's a guarantee today. But the one thing I see is if we try to see the positive, that will weigh the hardship of the pandemic.
So can I ask you a question? And I do radio, so I ask this question a lot. What did you learn about yourself that you did not know when the stay at home started? I mean, you don't have the distraction of going to work, caught in traffic, going to dinner, because it's like God pressed pause for a lot of reasons. So what did you learn about yourself that you didn't know?
I discovered more my needs as a person. Mm-hmm. And also I learned a lot about appreciation. Mm-hmm. Just appreciating the small things. Even with the father, my son's father, we help each other more now. Just because mm-hmm. I'm on my own, you're on your own, we'd better help each other.
Right, right.
It means the appreciation part.
Mm-hmm. I think when we learn different things about ourselves, when the doors are open back up, we're going to approach this whole thing much different. More thankful, more calm, more appreciative of life. But I think that a lot of us are learning things about ourselves that we didn't know. And I think that's a good thing. And you're learning things about your son, your own children that you did not know. So that's why I was curious, like, what did you learn about yourself?
That's right.
I think one of the other things we're learning about is patience. And I know having a house full, you know, with my husband and my children home, there's going to be a lot more patience for a variety of reasons. I want to go back to the point we talked about a little while ago about the stress and the uneasiness around all of this. You know, we talked about my senior not having a prom or graduation and transitioning to college, which is not going to look traditionally like college typically would. But it's also a transition for the parents that are going through this situation, because this is the age where children become young adults, and they don't want to be parented so much anymore. They want to be mentored. Mm-hmm. And so parents are learning how to do that, who they've never known how to do it before. And but children still need, or young adults still need, because of the situation, a little more parenting than they typically would at that age level.
I agree with that.
So if there's stress on both sides, and I think it really speaks to learning more patience with each other.
Mm-hmm. Right. I totally agree with you on that one.
This is really great. And I think a lot of people have discovered many things during this lockdown. Mm-hmm. However, there's also a big majority of people who became unemployed.
Yeah.
And just today I saw that we had the lowest GDP ever in the US, and really a record number of unemployment. And I think this is a real big issue for working moms, and especially single working moms. And we just had a small conversation with Loretta, saying that she's looking for a job right now. Mm-hmm. And she has a child that is going to be homeschooling, and depending if the schools will reopen or not. What are the other income sources or what are the other creative ways to start being financially independent if you lost your job? And also, what's the quickest way to find a job at this situation?
Well, who is the young lady that lost her job, that's looking for a job?
Oh, it's me. It's Loretta.
Loretta. So yes. Loretta, she has my email address. Send your resume to her. I have 48,000 LinkedIn connections, and I've got 10,000 followers that can't be accepted. So I will gladly push your resume out there to help you get a job. I've found a few people a job, so I want to use that platform correctly. And if it's helping another, person, because it's going to take a village to get through this. We're not going to be able to do this by ourselves. But I was talking to a young lady last night, and she was dealing with the same thing. But she knows how to braid hair. She knows how to twist hair and all these different things. So I gave her an idea. I said, listen, why don't you do this? Parents have their kids at home. You could be the extracurricular activity. Charge $150 a month for 1 hour class a week. And with that, maybe you buy the mannequin head. You mail all that to the child after they sign the contract and everything. And once a week, them along with other children will get on the internet or Zoom like we're on now, and you can teach them how to braid hair or to do styles in hair. If you know how to sew, you can teach them how to sew. I think this is a good time, whatever that gift that God has given you, it is a survival skill for later. You know, it may come a time you can't buy clothes. We don't know what's going to happen. I mean, I get up every day and say, what part of Revelation is going to play out today? So get back to what you know that you can do good. And there are parents that are like, please take them for an hour on the internet, teach them that. If it's a life skill, I'll pay for it. Does that make sense?
I think it's a really important point, because what I wanted to add was that this is a really good time for people to think through what their real career goals are.
Exactly.
If they've lost a position, is that something they still want to pursue? If so, fine, go move ahead with it. But if not, think through what you really want out of life. This is a really good time to ponder that. I think there's a lot of working mothers that are trying to keep their jobs and need help at home with their daycare and homeschooling their children. And if you find you have time on your hands, that'd be a great way to make a little bit of money in helping another mother while you're out there looking. And you never know what resources you might meet working with another working mom. Mm-hmm.
That's true.
I appreciate that we've got to think creatively and think through all sorts of ways that we could put ourselves out there.
Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, people are always saying there's going to be a lot of babies born in this time around November, December. And I think there's going to be visions that are born. I think people are going to, they're being disciplined now to actually run their own business. I think that we're going to see new businesses pop up because you don't have any distractions and you're mastering your craft. I think next year is going to be a pretty awesome year. I think we're going to see a lot of new business owners because what we see now, we know we cannot trust into the system. We cannot trust that we'll keep a job. So we're going to have to create our own.
Right. And I think they're going to be very creative. And I think if you have a hobby that you love, maybe now's the time to turn it into a career. Who knows? And who knows that it would be financially viable. But this is the time to think those things through.
And if you charge someone, if you can get 25 parents to commit to you for $150 a month to teach them sewing, but you got to add value. You know, the whole thing is that, okay, I pay this and the kids get a box in the mail for their supplies for their class. And then when they graduate, you send them a certificate, fill it with confetti, you know, the whole thing. They sign contracts, they get letters, they have appointments. And you take $150 and you can convince 25 people that you can teach that child a craft, that's almost $4,000 a month. I know there's a young girl that is on YouTube that my daughter Frances follows. She said, Mommy, she started out doing makeup tutorials. Within 6 months, she was up to $17,000 a month. So and then there's this thing called data. I always say it wrong, monetization. You create a website. This is why when you go on websites now, they ask for your email address. This is the way Facebook made all of this money. So when you go to a website, they always want your email address. It's because they sell it. Now, you get 20,000 emails. They want 10,000. They give you $2 for each email every month. That's $20,000 a month, but you got to have something for them to come there for, to create that traffic. And it could be your class.
Right. And I think the important fact here is like really writing out your goals and then seeing if you're working towards them. Because I think one of the challenges here is when you create a routine and it's been completely changed up, since the pandemic, you need to create a new routine for yourself to be able to achieve those goals and keep your eyes on the ball and also get all of your family to be invested in that big vision. Mm-hmm. So they know if they can even contribute to like bigger kids, they can definitely contribute creatively. They can teach you a lot about social media, for example. And just in general, give you some ideas. But I want to start discussing the issue that is very close to heart to a lot of women. And that's something that even prevents women to going into workforce even before they have children, is the maternity leave and how long it is. Definitely how short it is in the U.S.
Yeah.
And then if we were to change the policies to actually have it longer and also be paid, how do you think that will impact the employers, like from their point of view, the taxpayers, and et cetera? Because I've heard, like, for example, I think it just makes sense to have at least 6 months, because that's how many months you wait before you take a puppy home from a puppy mill or wherever you get them from. So they don't separate the dog with their moms. How come we separate the moms before 6 months with their children, even if you can afford it and everything, and even if she wants to really go to work? I'm not arguing that at all. I'm just trying to see how we can make it sustainable and possible, because there are a lot of arguments against that, from the taxpayers' views, and also just in general, that companies will start discriminating against women from even hiring them if they know that they will have to pay long-term maternity leaves. So I'm sure, like, all three of you have really long corporate careers in and the policymaking careers, that probably you would know what are we talking about here, and is it possible to push this agenda for working women?
Well, I see a few things. If we could just jump in there, and, you know, again, I'm the goat in this picture.
But it's your topic, the gender topic.
That's your topic. Sure.
But, you know, I see a lot of this stuff in studies, and because we push, what is it that gets in the way of women's economic empowerment? There are a number of things: access to various resources, and so on. Do they own property? Can they have bank accounts? So this country's better. We're not perfect, but better on that. But the thing that comes up over and over again is time poverty, which has, and a lot of flexibility issues in the workplace. How well does an employer adjust to the reality of complex lives outside of the home? Women are still called on for unpaid care, for elder care, for child care. You know, a mother and father both working. Who does the school call when the child is sick? Usually the mother, right?
That's right.
Right.
You know, hopefully that will change someday and we'll have something more equitable. But in the meantime, part of it is having the flexibility with employers who can say, we can have a flexible schedule. We don't have to have you from 8 to 5 with no time off in between. You can make it up here, you can make it up there. And of course, a lot of that's happening right now. I'm blessed, though it doesn't hit me the same way, but I'm blessed to work in an office with all women who really understand each other's problems and requirements. The flexibility for time off, for whether it's annual leave or sick leave, or just flex time because they're all raising kids, they've all got this stuff going. I've never taken advantage of telework, although I could have. Today I find out I actually rather like it. I'm not sure how much I want to go back to the office every day when that opportunity arises.
But I think a lot of people feel that way.
Yeah, I think so too. I think it's fascinating, and I'm an extrovert. But on the maternity, or better yet, parental leave, where we're also ensuring that men can take time off and encouraging them to do so, some of the things that we're seeing in companies that have promoted longer, more usually just maternal leave, but maybe it's parental leave and it can be divided between the wife and the husband, but it can't be saved for a vacation 2 years from now, right? They can have this amount of time. Some of the companies have found that this investment in their employees is getting greater productivity, and it is bringing them back later and keeping them there, that it creates a loyalty benefit, that the employees are dedicated much more to the company, which is women tend to be anyway, but this is an add-on, and that the fear of the lost productivity and all of that during the period of women having time off has not been realized. In fact, the productivity increases when they come back because of the relationship that's been built in great part. From the tax side, I just wish we in the US would realize we can afford to do this. A lot of people fight anything that's got to come out of the tax budget. People love Rosie the Riveter and this idea of, you know, the women who took over the factories and ran the country's factories during World War II. How did that happen? The government paid for childcare. Companies paid for childcare. How did we make sure that the boys, when they came home, could get their jobs back? we eliminated the childcare and the women had to go back out of the workforce. Well, what we found was women could run these factories. They could produce, they were producing munitions. They were producing war equipment. They were producing the food that the soldiers ate. They were producing all of that. It wasn't male versus female capacity. It was who's allowed to. And by disallowing women the opportunity, or by allowing them, by providing the child care needed, we had a big impact. And it was actually a policy decision to remove the child care so women would go back home and fit into their traditional roles as homemakers, which was never a role that everybody got to have. Many women were working full-time for other women who were able to take the time off. I think we do need a commitment. There will be resistance. There's a business case to be argued for it. Many women, there is a faction of society, not just women, women and men, and some of us in the faith community know this very well, that just actually believe that a woman's place is in the home and that that's biblical and that women taking these jobs are taking men's jobs away, et cetera. And, you know, and if we provide childcare, then all these strangers will be raising our children, we'll have a dysfunctional society, blah, 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 blah. You know, take any time in history and find me a non-dysfunctional society and I'll tell you, you're not reading history, you're reading fantasy.
Right.
Exactly.
These fears have already been realized with the existing system. So why don't we try something else?
Let me offer a concrete example. Early in my career, I worked for a large consulting firm, and the issue of, you know, working mothers was coming up more and more and more. And so the solution that this company came up with was to put a daycare in the office on Saturdays so the parents could come to work on Saturdays and work their weekends.
Oh, wow.
You look at that, look back on that, and I really shake my head. And today, you know, organizations have built daycares into their companies. There are, you know, they list the top 100 companies or whatever for working mothers every year. My husband did have paternity leave. Our oldest child, we didn't leave until he was 6 months old because we used our leave back to back. I went back to work at 14 weeks and then my husband took his 12 weeks and stayed home and we didn't leave until he was 6 months old. And I had the option of taking him back to work with me, but I chose not to do that because I knew he would always be my responsibility if I did. If he gets sick and he's with me, there's no way my husband's ever going to be able to step up and come and get him. So I think there's a lot of things that women need to look at when they are looking for an organization in which they want to work. You don't want those organizations that are providing daycare for you on the weekends so you can work 7 days a week, 24 hours.
Yeah. That's silly.
You know, you have to set limits for you. You have to understand your limits and set boundaries around those limits. And sometimes you have to say no. I turned down a few promotions in my career because I knew I was at capacity. And I knew if I said, going back to the point made earlier, if I said yes to that boss, I was saying no to my family and my children.
Exactly.
And I was not willing to do that. So, yeah, I think there are options in looking for positions, especially corporate positions, where you don't go to those organizations that won't support you.
Right.
I changed jobs one time because I had a boss that just had never had children and didn't understand what I had to be committed to. And I went and found another job within the same organization because I knew I was never going to be able to set my boundaries with her.
Right.
So you really have to take responsibility for doing your research and figuring out what's going to be the best fit for you, your capacity, your limits, and what you want to do given your personal situation.
So I think that what needs to happen is that there needs to be bigger conversations with our congressmen and senators.
Exactly.
Because right now we're cutting grass and getting mad because it's growing back. That's what it's supposed to do. So until we get to the root of it and destroy it at the root, when you start dealing with the congressmen, congresswomen, and I think they've got more women running for Congress this year than ever. And, you know, making this is an issue. And then it becomes a wonderful thing that our company offers 6 months off. You know, they would love that PR, but You know, we can look for a job and then all of a sudden it'll change. And we can think they'll do this and then it'll change. It needs to be something that's kind of more ironclad. interesting enough, with COVID now, it'll be an easier conversation to have because I don't think we're going to go back to normal for a while. It'll be an easier conversation to have, but I think we need to put more pressure on our political leaders to get done, because right now we're just cutting grass and we're mad because it grew back, but that's what it does when you don't get to the root.
Right, I agree with that, certainly.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. It's been a really deep and useful conversation, and it's almost to be 2 p.m. I wanted to just ask if there are any questions from our participants, because I think we will be rounding up soon.
I don't have any. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Oh, okay. Thank you. No, I don't have any questions, but I just want to say thank you so much. This has been great. I've gotten a lot of great takeaways from this, writing down your goals. And I really love that emailing recap. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, I really love that. So thank you so much to all the panelists. It's been great.
Great. Yeah.
And Norma, may I make one more point quickly?
Yeah, sure, definitely.
We've talked a lot about setting goals and working towards them, but I think it's important to note that there's another step in there, is that not only do we need to set goals, we need to understand what needs to change in our lives to be able to meet those goals.
Amen.
You can say, gee, I'd like to be a rocket scientist, but you know, you're a dog walker. So that's a great goal, but what do things need to change in my life? What do I need to do to be able to achieve that goal? So we don't just say, okay, I want to do this, but you have no idea how to get there. You've got to have a path to be able to meet that goal.
Mm-hmm. That makes a lot of sense.
And definitely, you can guide us through this.
Oh, just yeah.
I just want to say, one, I've read the brain science studies, I've seen about the MRIs, the scanning and so on. It seems to be learned behavior, which is really good news because it means that we can change, we can learn new behavior. It's not set in our DNA that men don't notice anything between the washer and the TV room, whereas a woman will notice everything out of place. One's been trained, the other's been allowed to get away with a lot.
I agree. That's an excellent point.
But the other thing there, here's my advice. People say, how do I get more men to, you know, pay attention or whatever? And this, I came up with something. I think hinting to, you've got to be specific, because hinting to men is generally like leaving a note for the dog. It may be really clear to you, but it's not going to work. I think specificity, the ask has to be real. We have these mechanisms of upbringing, lack of emotional intelligence, etc. Again, upbringing, where we can, you can say, oh, did you take the trash out? And I can say no, and go back to watching TV. Well, that's not the question. The question is, can you take the trash out?
Can you take it out?
Be specific, be real, and be as generous as the situation allows, and it doesn't always.
I think my last takeaway is that this journey that we're on now is more spiritual than it is natural. It's very important that you surround yourself around people that will tell you what's right with you and not what's always wrong with you. That will remind you who you are, what your gifts and what your talents are, because this situation here will make you forget who you are. So you got to have people that's going to remind you, you are totally awesome. You know, I used to do this with a team I manage. I say, write out a resume. But in this resume, I want you to handwrite it. And I want you to include even your accomplishments in high school and in college. I raised a child by myself. I was able to buy a home by myself. I worked for this company and I did this. And hang that somewhere like a trophy. So on those days where you feel like, I'm going to take Xanax and shoot it straight in my arm. Look at your trophy case. If you did that, you can do this. But it's very important who you allow to feed into you in this season, because the news is negative. Conversations are negative. keep a positive circle of people around me at all times.
Absolutely.
Yes, that is really great. That's so true. And that's why I think our webinar today really attracted the really great speakers and also the participants that had such great questions and who shared their stories, how they've dealt with this situation. And I cannot just be more grateful today. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anar.
Thank you so much, Anar.
Thank you.